Good morning and welcome to worship. This being the ninth Sunday of Pentecost, it is August 2nd. I have some announcements that I would like to share with you. First off, I ask that you keep the family of Bob Tompkins in your prayer. Bob passed away on Friday. And then many of you may remember Gene Wilcox. He played the saxophone that was like a straight saxophone. His wife Nancy passed away this last week as well, so please keep them in prayer. Next Sunday, which is going to be August 9th, we are planning on meeting in the parking lot for worship. It will not be as advanced as it has in the past. We will not have the radio available to us, and I'm not even sure we'll have the trailer available to us. So it's going to be a little bit different. We'll have the speakers, and we just want to gather and partake in communion and hear God's word. So if you would like to join us in the parking lot, that is at 8 a.m. Also for the month of August, if you are a Zoom user or would like to join us using Zoom, we will be doing an adult forum at 9:30 on Zoom. The address or the link to the adult forum is on our Facebook page as well as our homepage, www.mountzionelca.com, and that's all lowercase. And you can click that link, and as long as you have Zoom on your computer, you can join us for an adult forum. And this week we're going to look at some scripture verses and just how are we growing and how are we doing as people of faith during these last 3-4 months. I do hope and pray that your faith growth, your relationship with Jesus is continuing to grow and become more mature. What are some of the challenges to that? And how have we been successful, or where have you found it pleasing to the Lord and you are finding yourself growing? We'd just like to share some of that together. And so if you're able to join us, we encourage you to do that as well. Just to let you know, if you are in town here, next Tuesday we have voting here. It will be in the narthex and possibly in the overflow into the sanctuary a little bit. And then also we do have a rummage sale. Let folks know that they can stop by any time during the week, Monday through Thursday, from 9 to 2. And just peruse. Please, a mask is required. We just have so much stuff. We just want people to come and be able to purchase it and get, I guess, more room. We're going to need more room. So please take advantage of that as well. And let folks know that they can stop in here. Other than that, I just hope you have a very blessed day. The Lord touch you in a very special and holy way this day and always. And please stay healthy. God bless you all. We love living our lives in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Abundant Lord, in our emptiness, we seek to fill ourselves in a hope that we will find completeness and peace. May our living be filled, O God of grace. By your grace, we indeed have filled our lives with many good things, and yet we still find ourselves empty and lacking. May our life be filled, O God of grace. Though we have filled our lives with many good things like family and friends, comfort and security, status and pleasure, we know all this has an end. May our living be filled, O God of grace. We hunger for that which is eternal and everlasting. We hunger for being known and being loved by you, O Lord. Come, O bread of life, and fill our living with your eternal presence, your unending love, and your infinite embrace, that we may be fed and be full. May our living be full, O God of grace. I ask that we observe a moment of silence for reflection and self-examination. Most merciful God,
We confess before you and along with other brothers and sisters of faith in Christ Jesus that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God in his mercy has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to us the entire forgiveness of all of our sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
I ask that we now join together in praying the prayer for this ninth Sunday after Pentecost. Together we pray. Gracious Father, your blessed Son came down from heaven to be the true bread, which gives life to the world. Give us this bread, that he may live in us and we in him. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Our reading for this ninth Sunday of the Pentecost season. Our first lesson, it comes from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 55, verses 1 through 5. Isaiah talks of a time where all will be able to be fed without cost and without pain, but with a promise that comes from God. Isaiah writes, "Ho, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you that have no money, come buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without price and without money. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread? And your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me, and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me. Listen, so that you may live. I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast, sure love for David. See, I made him a witness to the peoples. a leader and a commander for the peoples. See, you shall call nations that you don't know, and nations that don't know you shall run to you because of the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel. For that one has glorified you. Here ends our first reading. Our Holy Gospel this day is one of Jesus's, perhaps his most famous miracle. We short-circuit it, and we talk about it as the feeding of the 5,000. But leading up to the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus intends, and you will hear it in our words today, Jesus intends that his disciples could take a break and just recoup, because Jesus has just gotten the horrible news that John the Baptist has died. He needs to think about it. He needs to reflect. He needs to grieve. But the people are in need. Hear the words today. From Matthew chapter 14, verses 13 to 21. Now when Jesus had heard about the death of John the Baptist, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. When the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to Jesus and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus looked to them and said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We've had nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And Jesus said, "Bring them here to me." Then Jesus ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples. And the disciples gave them to the crowds, and all ate and were filled. And they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. This is the gospel of our Lord. Okay, welcome to the children's sermon. If you're scattered around your house, come on down. We're going to take and have a time where we get a chance to talk about Jesus feeding the 5,000. What in the world are you eating at home? Are you sick and tired of eating and cooking the same things over and over and over again? They've become so monotonous to you that I bet you that you're ready for some variety. Well, tell you what, Jesus and his disciples and the people basically were all together. And what did they ask? "Jesus, send them away. Let them go to McDonald's. Because they got to eat." And Jesus looked to them and said, "Hey, guess what, guys? You give them something to eat." Huh? Remember, we talk about in the Bible, it says 5,000 men plus women and children. They weren't even counting the kids and the moms. It was like literally all of these people. Well, so they come to Jesus and basically say, "Guess what? We found 5 loaves of bread. 5 loaves of bread now and 2 fish. Now, granted, I didn't have fish. I didn't have some sardines, but I got a loaf of bread. Now, can you imagine that literally you were excited to get a slice of bread? Now, I don't know about you, but I think in our day and age, we would at least have peanut butter to go with the bread. But no, they just had bread. How boring is that? Well, maybe one of those things is that Jesus knows about how people are. And even though we continually take and challenge Jesus and we say, "Okay, what are we going to eat today?" Have you gone to mom and dad and say, "Okay, are we having the same thing over and over again?" Now, some of you wouldn't mind, because I would bet you that somewhere in your house you got a box of macaroni and cheese. But even if you just ate macaroni and cheese every single meal and every single day, you would get tired of it. Well, Here's the thing. When Jesus is talking about to his disciples and teaching and preaching and sharing that, he's not talking about bread. He's not talking about mac and cheese. He's not talking about peanut butter. The three food groups. Jesus is talking about something else. He's talking about the kingdom of heaven. And he's talking about that ability to know that we all get a chance to celebrate with Jesus. We all are part of that kingdom. We all are part of the family of God. And when we hear about the miracle of Jesus' feeding, it's more that his word continues to feed us and encourage us and give us the hope that we need. And to be grateful for what we do have to eat. Even if it is just peanut butter, mac and cheese, and some bread. Because truly all are blessings as they come from our Lord. As you continue to take and enjoy this time of getting to know your family way too well, be kind to one another. Be kind to your brothers and sisters. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you that you give us the encouragement that we need. We thank you, Lord, for the food that doesn't spoil, the food that doesn't simply rot. But give us, O Lord, and give thanks for the food that sustains us more, that word that does give us the spice that we need. In your name we pray. Amen.
From the book of Matthew and the book of Mark. The apostles returned to Jesus from their ministry tour and told him all they had done and taught. As soon as Jesus heard the news, he left in a boat to a remote area to be alone. But the crowds heard where he was headed and followed on foot from many towns. Jesus saw the huge crowd as he stepped from the boat, and he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things and healed their sick. Late in the afternoon, his disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place, and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go into the nearby farms and villages and buy food for themselves." But Jesus said, "That isn't necessary. You feed them." "With what?" they asked. "We would have to work for months to earn enough money to buy food for all these people." "How much bread do you have?" he asked. "Go and find out." They came back and reported, "We have only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. "Bring them here," he said. Then he told the people to sit down on the grass. Jesus took the 5 loaves and 2 fish, looked up towards heaven, and blessed them. Then breaking the loaves into pieces, he gave the bread to the disciples, who distributed it to the people. He also divided the fish for everyone to share. They all ate as much as they wanted, and afterward, his disciples picked up 12 baskets of leftover bread and fish. A total of 5,000 men and their families were fed.
Break thou the bread of life, dear Lord, to me. As thou didst break the loaves beside the sea, beyond the sacred page I seek thee, Lord. My spirit waits for thee, O living Word. Bless your own truth, dear Lord, to me, as when you blessed the bread by Galilee, then shall all bondage cease, all fetters fall, and I shall find my peace, my all in all. You are the bread of life, O Lord, to me. Your holy word Lord, the truth that rescues me. Give me to eat and live with you above. Teach me to love your truth, for you.
Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations and thoughts of everyone who sees and hears my voice this day be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, we do pray. Amen. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and our Savior, Jesus, who is the Christ, the risen Son of God. Amen. If there was one miracle that you would know well, if someone basically said, name a miracle of Jesus, I would almost bet that the feeding of the 5,000 would be either number one or number two, or changing the water into wine as number one or number two. We know this scripture because we hear it all the time. When we think about the feeding of the 5,000, virtually every single gospel has this miracle in it, because it's one of those life-changing, life-altering miracles that talk to us about the promise and the presence of God. Sometimes we get so wrapped up in the miracle that we forget all the other stuff that was going in and amongst and around it. In Matthew, as I said earlier, Jesus has just been given the news that John the Baptist has died. One that baptized him in the River Jordan, one that proclaimed, one that prepared, one that was literally seeing the culmination of this ministry which Jesus was doing, had suddenly died and was killed by King Herod. Wow. What do you even do with that? We know in our own lives about when loved ones have died. We're kind of a loss. And we need that time to grieve. We need that time to really just try to get our life back together. And Jesus was looking to do that. He needed to step back from the ministry. He needed to recharge, or at the very least, honor his friend, honor that one who went before him. But the need of the world did not allow it. He wanted to go to that deserted place. And lo and behold, guess what? As with anything, the crowds saw the boats, the crowds knew where he was going, and they beat him to that place. They said, oh, this must be where he's going to dock the boats. Let's get there. Let's get the front row seats, because I've got a relative that really needs to be healed. I've got one that literally needs to be touched by the miraculous hand of this Jesus guy. And so they raced with their sick. They raced with those who were in need, those literally limping and leprosy, and think of all the various diseases and ailments. And they were running to find hope. They were running to find that last resort. They were trying to find that last doctor that would give them a comfort for their ailment and for their loved ones. They didn't care that Jesus had been going. They didn't care about the various things that were going on in their life. They didn't even think about the sacrifices of emotion that Jesus was doing. We think about this time, and we're surrounded by the news. And we are thankful for those first responders and those people in the medical profession that literally are working tirelessly to try and help strangers. Strangers. They don't know us, but they're working for us and on our behalf. Out of our need, we come and say, please help. Thankfully, there are those that are sacrificing home and family to be there for us. Jesus himself saw the crowd, saw the need, and had compassion on them. He didn't say, go away from me, I've got to spend some time out here. He said, I need to speak, I need to teach, I need to cure the sick. And so it went on and on and on. Until it became dusk and it was time for it to wrap up. They come to the end of the day and the disciples said, Jesus, you've got to stop. You've been going all day. We got to stop now. We need a break and these people have to go into the villages and find food for themselves. Dismiss them. Let them go away. We're tired. Please, and you need a break. It's been constant. Let them go and buy food. And Jesus looks at them and says to the disciples and his followers, well, you guys give them something to eat. What? You give them something to eat. Can't you just see the deer in the headlight look of the disciples? Jesus, you got to be nuts. We don't have that much food. We don't have clothes. Early on, when I was in my first church, it was always amazing to me the miracle of the potluck dinner. The miracle of the potluck, where literally people would just bring food to share and you would immediately have confidence that it's going to happen. And I know I probably said this before because it's one of those things that I just realized, again, that I asked one of the experienced church women. You know, when I say experienced, this wasn't their first go-around when they were talking about potluck dinners. I actually asked them, because of course you do a potluck after funerals and all this stuff in North Dakota. And I asked them, so what happens when there's not as much food as there is people? It's not like they had some stuff stuffed in the fridge someplace. In her wonderful Norwegian accent, she looked at me straight in the eye and said, we just use smaller spoons. Instead of the big serving spoons, we use smaller spoons so that all could get a little bit and so that people don't get a lot and wait till the end. And in that little bit of wisdom, I realized that this was not her first rodeo. You could tell that had happened, and you could tell that perhaps even her mother or grandmother had given her that advice. How to stretch a meal. How to make it work. How to literally create something virtually out of nothing. Well, today we get a chance. Jesus says, okay, guys, what do you got? And they said, well, we got 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And Jesus looked at it and went, okay, that's what we got. That's what we're going to work with. Had the crowd sit down in the grass, blessed it, broke it, shared it. And there was enough. A miracle. a miracle. What I think is kind of ironic is that Jesus took something and created a miracle. And I don't know, there's been various people down through the ages who said, well, because of that, it caused people to share, and literally, suddenly, everybody was fed and happy, and they got the baskets left over. But I think there's also another promise to that, is that God's word cannot be stopped. God's word continues to take and work even when we think it's not going to work. We literally get so wrapped up in the limitations we only have that we lose sight about what we do have. What Jesus had been talking about all afternoon to the people was each one was given a renewed sense of hope. When someone would come with their sickness or sick friend or whatever, Jesus would literally say, God loves you. You are a child of God. Be strong. Be well. And what's interesting is sometimes we take it as only physical. But think of that sense of mental peace that happens when you know that you have been claimed, called, forgiven child of God. Jesus' ministry and Jesus' message isn't about the bread and the fish. That's just a byproduct. His message is what Isaiah said about that suddenly all will come together, sharing in that wonderful meal which God has provided for us. That meal that looks like it's out of nothing. And yet, it's a magnificent feast. My daughter, from the time that she was very young, thought it was an absolute miracle that my mom, out of her little kitchen, could suddenly be feeding 25 people and it not be a big deal. Mom knew how to do things. Mom knew how to feed people. She could take the meagerness and create a meal that we just assumed and ate. Perhaps you've had that experience as you look to the pantry and go, I have nothing. And then you start to throw things together and a miracle happens. Well, know that that miracle continues to happen. That miracle of God's love, that miracle of God's grace, that miracle of God's presence and promise in your life. We are going through this uncertain time, and some of us have become so angry and frustrated that literally we can't contain ourselves. But here's the encouragement. Here's the thing that you get the chance to hear. And that is that promise that God does give us the hope that we need this year, this moment, this day. And for us, our responsibility is when we feel frustrated, is to remember whose we are as children of God, representatives of that grace and love that has come from our Heavenly Father. Today, know that and believe that as we come together this day and always. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, we do pray for those who are feeling isolated today. We pray, Lord, that as your word has been from generation to generations of people that have gone through much worse and yet still hung on to that hope, give us that ability to hang on, O God. We ask this and we pray for the responders and the medical people. We pray, Lord, for those that make our life surprisingly easier. We ask, Lord, for even those that provide food for us, that we can go to the grocery store have it either curbside, pick up, delivered. But we have that food, O Lord, and give you thanks for that. Lord, we bless this time and understanding that we are your children. Lord, let's join together in praying together that prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the benediction. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of Christ my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises.